Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne, and today we're getting enthusiastic about how grammars come into existence. But first, we are doing a live show in April. We will be doing a live show recording on the internet so that we can all be in the same place at the same time on Saturday, the 24th of April, Eastern Daylight Savings Time in North America, which will be early on a Sunday morning for us here in Australia.
That'll be 6 p.m. for me on Eastern Daylight Time, and we will include a link to a time zone converter so you can figure out when that is for you.
We'll be doing the whole show about back channeling, which is all those ways that you actively listen to someone as they're talking. Thank you for that excellent back channeling, Gretchen. Something I think a lot about in our era of lots of video calls and online chats.
You can't see me, but I'm doing a thumbs up right now.
Excellent back channeling.
So these are some kinds of back-channeling. We're going to be talking about lots of more. And I think it's fun to do a live show about back-channeling because it means that you get to back-channel in the chat while the show's going on and chat with each other. So that'll be fun. We're running the ticketing of the show through Patreon. So if you're a patron, you'll automatically get a link to the live show to join. If you'd like to become a patron, you can also do that to get access to the live show stream.
Patrons also get access to our recent bonus episode on reduplication, as well as 48 other bonus episodes, because we have almost 50 now.
That's a lot. Lots of Lingthusiasm for patrons, which helps keep the show running.
Our live show is part of Lingfest, which will be taking place across the last week of April, which is an online series of events about linguistics. You can find out more about Lingfest at lingcom.org/lingfest.
That's com with two M's, as in communication. And speaking of Lingcom, if you're interested in communicating linguistics to broader audiences, you can also join the Lingcom conference, which is a conference for practitioners of linguistics communication, such as ourselves and many other cool Lingcomers, to learn from each other and help produce more interesting and engaging materials for all of you.
Lingcom, the conference, is taking place online the week of April the 19th.
And you can also go to lingcom.org/conference to see the schedule and other details there.
That's com with two M's.
Lauren, how many people would you say you know who have written a grammar of a language?
Okay. Well, both my PhD supervisors. I'd say half the people in the department that I currently work in, I have written a grammar of a language. This is a perfectly common activity among my professional cohort. I assume it's a thing most people do and know about, and so we don't really have to explain it for this episode at all. It's fine.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, at least several of the people that I went to grad school with, not necessarily at my university, people I knew from conferences, you know, professors that I knew, one professor I knew had her grammar come out the same year that her baby came out, and she posted a photo of the grammar and the baby, which were about the same size, on Facebook after that happened. It was really cute.
Grammars definitely take longer than 9 months to gestate. I can definitely confirm that.
I have not written a grammar. So when someone's going about writing a grammar, what, you know, so, okay, here's a language, there isn't a grammar written, or the grammar that's written of it is not adequate. What do I do to start?
So what you're talking about is taking all of the amazing complexity of how humans use language and finding the rules that reoccur within a particular language and then finding a way of articulating that concisely in written form in a grammar so that by the end you've worked through most of the common features you find in this language, all of the variations and irregularities, and you've put that into some kind of readable book format for other people to then learn about how the grammar of this language works. That is the overarching aim of this endeavor.
So I've consulted grammars in the process of doing linguistics. I have the Cambridge Grammar of the English Language sitting on my desk. When I was in grad school, I spent a lot of time consulting Valentine 2001's Grammar of Anishinaabemowin. You know, there are grammars that I've consulted, and they're like 1,000 pages, 2,000 pages long. So sometimes you get a really massive grammar, sometimes you get a shorter sort of sketch grammar, and they have certain sort of similarities in the structure and the types of things that people cover in a grammar.
Yeah, absolutely. You tend to start traditionally with smaller bits and work upwards. So you're likely to find a description, if it's a spoken language, of the sound system, or if it's a signed language, of the hand shape and body space phonology at the beginning of the book, and then work up to word level. You know, you'd probably expect, if a language has adjectives, a section on adjectives, which we've talked about before.
We have talked a lot about adjectives.
And then if you're looking at kind of sentence level stuff, like asking a question, how you do that, it happens at the level of the sentence. That tends to be more towards the end. So you're going from kind of smaller bits up to bigger bits. And then it really depends on the tradition. And we've talked about lumpers and splitters before. If you like to split things down, a grammar is great because you can have so many subheadings. I remember reading the rules for one set of grammars where it was like, please do not go beyond 5 layers of headings. And I was like, that's actually quite a challenge.
Because you have your chapter level headings, and then you're like, oh, okay, but you know, if this chapter is about verbs, you've got this type of verbs and those type of verbs, or within the transitive verbs, you've got this type of verbs and those type of verbs, and so on. And so
then you've got the irregularities. Right. They might need their own subset.
Right.
So you kind of can go from the table of contents, you can get this kind of big picture, and then go down and down and down into the different sections. And the grammar that I wrote of Lum Jung Yolmo was a sketch grammar, so it's only a couple of hundred pages, and it makes sure to knock over. It would be very weird to like have nothing about nouns in a language that very obviously has nouns, mm-hmm. but it doesn't go into kind of the deep level of detail on some things that a longer grammar gets to. There's always more to be done as well.
Yeah, any grammar is going to be incomplete, even these massive sort of doorstop-sized grammars.
Yeah.
You know, you're going to leave some stuff out where you're a speaker and you're like, I know this, but you don't necessarily include it in a grammar. I've also read in grad school, I don't remember what language it was of, but I picked up this grammar that was written in like, I want to say maybe the 70s or 80s, and there was clearly some sort of fad for doing this very abstract schematic thing of sentences or verbs or something, and it didn't have any like complete sentences or complete verbs just written there. It drew them all on this diagram that I have never encountered before or since, where everything was sort of like pieceable together. I was like, oh wow, so this is clearly some sort of, you're participating in some sort of grammatical tradition that I'm just not aware of here.
I mean, I think the important thing is that grammars are written by humans, and humans are trained by other humans within particular traditions. And I remember when I was building my sketch grammar, it was while I was also working on my thesis, because I was looking specifically at evidentials, but you can't know what's happening with evidentiality without understanding how verbs work and how verbs relate to other parts of the sentence. And then I realized I was accidentally on my way to writing out the bones of the grammar of Lum Jung Yolmo.
Sometimes you just accidentally write a grammar.
And that is how I accidentally started and very deliberately finished writing that sketch grammar. But I remember talking to my supervisors, and one of them found it quite unusual that I wanted to include the methodology in my grammar. So I wanted to explain specifically who I'd worked with, what I'd recorded, what kinds of elicitation I'd used. And that wasn't in that supervisor's grammar tradition, but it was something I wanted to include.
And a lot of grammars aren't going to include the gestures of the language or something, which I know is one of your things that you enjoy.
Yes. So there are kind of, you know, traditions that do focus more on narrative structure, and you might find more about the structure of narratives in a grammar, and others that focus more on verb structure. And so, you know, there's a very brief few pages on phonetics, and then a really massive chapter on verbs. And it's sometimes because the language has lots of really fun, complex things happening with the verbs, but sometimes it's just because that's what that person was interested in.
This person was a verb fan.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and some parts, you know, it'd be pretty hard to do a grammar without doing some level of, you know, phonology at the beginning. But yeah, you what level of sort of pragmatic stuff at the end, you know, discourse stuff, or like, how does people in this language talk to children or something like that, that might not be in a grammar.
Yeah, I'm doing a paper with a colleague on onomatopoeia at the moment, and some grammars will have a separate section on that. And because it's not as central to every single sentence as, say, nouns and verbs can be for a lot of languages, it doesn't tend to crop up as its own specific subsection in a lot of grammars.
Which doesn't necessarily mean the language doesn't have automatopoeia, it's just that it didn't get the kind of focused attention that got put there.
This is always the question that you have while reading a grammar write, is it's about what makes it in, but it's also what doesn't. And sometimes things don't make it in because of trends or because of what people are focusing on, or sometimes just because they're important but incredibly low frequency things that happen. Or, you know, if someone is doing field work and they come into a community as a man, they might spend a lot of time around other men and recording a particular variety. And that's where the methodology was really important for me, to kind of make clear why I was making choices. And also the title of a grammar. I find it really interesting whether people say, you know, the grammar of or a grammar of. Mm. And I very consciously called it a grammar, or a sketch grammar of Lum Jung Yelmo, because this is just my analysis and my take. And other people might come to exactly the same data with different conclusions, or they might be way more into adjectives than I am, and that section is way more fleshed out in someone else's analysis.
And that's sort of an interesting side effect, as you were saying about, okay, well, if we want to look at onomatopoeia in a bunch of languages, or if you want to look at any sort of thing, whether it's verbs or sounds or hand shapes or something in a bunch of different languages, okay, how can, you know, if you're making those beautiful graphs, like are in the Walls database, which we've mentioned before, or if you're going to write a Wikipedia article about, like, here's how this language works, or here's how this phenomenon works, the grammars turn into the sort of input material of what gets cited there.
Yeah, those big overviews are often built up from these grammars of different languages. And that's where having, you know, structures that are easy for people to access in the table of contents becomes really easy, because just as there's a human writing the grammar, there's another human reading the grammar to put into those databases.
And, you know, dictionaries are often a very collaborative project where you have, you know, a bunch of people kind of contributing words or contributing entries, and you can say, okay, you know, you need to take care of the letter P and see what's going on here. But a grammar is often written by one person, so it kind of reflects that one person.
Yeah, and almost like the very overwhelming majority of the time, it's people who aren't members of that community. It's a linguist who's trained as a linguist and then come into this community and, you know, often built incredibly long-term deep relationships with those communities and speak the language, but not always. And I know I'm kind of, it's very easy to over-problematize something you do and spend a lot of time thinking about. But again, it's worth remembering while reading a grammar.
Right. And what types of things you think are interesting, what types of things you think are novel or worth drawing attention to, or what types of things you think are common, is a function of what you've been exposed to from a grammatical tradition. So I've been thinking a lot about this question of what do we put in a grammar, and, you know, how is a grammar constructed by the societal context in which it's written? Because I've been reading this book called Grammar West to East by Edward MacDonald.
Oh.
The subtitle is The Investigation of Linguistic Meaning in European and Chinese Traditions.
Cool.
I will say, you know, at the beginning, this is an academic book. It is a monograph. If you don't have a background in linguistics, you'll find it fairly dense going, potentially. But as someone who does, it's really interesting.
Awesome. Pick out the anecdotes for us.
One of the first observations that it makes, and when you think about this, it's totally true, is that, so the European grammatical tradition is based on Latin and Greek. And Latin and Greek are languages where you do a lot of changing the endings on words, sometimes the prefixes, but often the endings on words to make them do grammatical things.
Yes.
And so the European grammatical tradition is a lot about making tables of all of the different ways that a word can inflect, and being like, well, it does this and it does this, and giving names to the different sorts of groupings and patterns that you find out of that.
Which is great for doing those things. It makes it a little bit confusing sometimes when you apply it to a language like English that doesn't have the same ending changes, but we give them the same labels.
Yes.
But that's because the analysis of English is very much in that Latin tradition.
It's inherited from the Latin tradition, and there's a sort of pedagogical motivation for some of this, because Latin and Greek were not just sort of like the languages that started out analyzing themselves, although they were that as well, but they were also considered prestigious languages that you needed to learn. And so a lot of the grammatical analysis of Greek and especially Latin were in terms of how to teach them to speakers of other European languages.
Hmm.
And it's like, here's a bunch of endings and you need to learn them, and you need to learn sort of what they correspond to and what their function is.
Right.
And what's interesting is that the grammar of Chinese is different from that. They don't do endings. What they do instead is you have things that have a grammatical function, but they're considered to have the sort of the same status as full words. And so the Chinese grammatical tradition is concerned with looking at those particles that have grammatical functions but are hard to write definitions of.
Mm-hmm.
And cataloging them and figuring out what's going on with them and sort of grouping them into groups. And there are some words in the European tradition, you know, that are invariant, which are often sort of all lumped together in adjectives.
Yeah.
You know, words like often or always or something like that, which are sort of, you know, they just look like that all the time. They don't have like endings like the verbs and the nouns do. But the Latin tradition grammarians didn't care about those words, and they were really into the endings. And the Chinese grammarians were really interested in, first of all, this sort of fundamental duality between words that had a meaning to them, had what they called full words,
mm-hmm.
and words that were only for their grammatical function, what they called empty words.
That is a great metaphor. I like it.
And also because culturally they were really interested in dualities, you know, the sun and the moon and the full words and the empty words, and having a sort of a nice mirrored duality was really appealing to them for sort of aesthetic reasons. In the same way that the European grammatical tradition is often descended from sort of the rhetorical tradition, because they were really interested in the aesthetics of rhetoric when it came to doing that sort of analysis. And so, you know, what your culture is sort of into aesthetically brings forth, okay, what are we trying to explain this? So both of these are sort of ancient history, you know, like around 2000 years ago, there were sort of the beginnings of this, you know, doing their own analysis of grammatical traditions. And you get this really interesting descriptive grammar that was published in 1898 by China's mm-hmm. first grammarian, Ma Jiangzong, called Mr. Ma's Complete Grammar, which I think is great.
That is an excellent late 1800s name of a book.
It is exactly of a particular era, and it's complete EAT, not ETE, which is just, you know.
Perfect.
And he was a native speaker of Chinese who had also been educated by Jesuits in French, and so he had exposure to both the French and the Chinese grammatical traditions, and he writes this grammar where he distinguishes between sort of full and empty words the way that the Chinese had, when, you know, introduces sort of particles to be these sort of empty words. But he also further subdivides the full words into the lexical categories that Europeans have been doing, which are verbs and nouns and so on. And this distinction between verbs and nouns and so on was really important to the Europeans because verbs and nouns have different types of endings. And so you know whether something's a verb or noun because the endings are all different.
Yeah.
Because this is a really endings-based grammatical system. And the modern conception of, you know, modern linguistic conception of how languages and their structures work is to a certain extent a hybrid of that, because this full and empty grammatical categories is now reflected in what linguists call content words and function words.
Yes.
So, you know, you have words like dog and cat and run and see and stuff like that, where you can actually write a definition. And then you have your grammatical words like of and is and to and stuff, which just sort of have this grammatical function. So this category that's still really relevant in modern linguistics is there, you know, in one country's grammatical tradition. But also modern linguistics does also still talk about nouns and verbs.
Absolutely.
And, you know, it's a sort of the history of the contact between these two grammatical traditions and how they figured out how to adapt things to each other is a sort of interesting way of looking at what is it that we think of as important when we're trying to write a grammar of, you know, a particular language, or we're trying to do grammar. And a lot of ancient grammar traditions were really concerned with describing one very prestigious sort of golden age language, or sort of one or two, you know, you've got to write your grammar of Latin or of Greek or of Old Chinese, because that's like the one everyone thinks is fancy. And the local vernacular that ordinary people talk, like, no one is going to write a grammar of that. But it's a very interesting way of thinking about, okay, what were people concerned about, and how did those interests derive from the structure of the language or languages that they were familiar with?
This book sounds so great, but I wonder if actually the title of it should be Grammars from East to West, because if we look at where our modern tradition of writing grammars in Europe is, it's very much motivated by those Latin grammars and grammarians of old. But it's also very influenced by Panini and the Sanskrit grammarian tradition that is like 2,500-3,000 years old as well.
Yeah, and one of the things that I was thinking about reading this, being like, wow, I didn't know, I knew some of the stuff about the European tradition, not all of it, but I didn't know most of the stuff about ancient China, thinking, I know that there was a grammatical, really interesting grammatical description going on in India, like right between these two major geographical regions. And there was a bunch of stuff going on in Arabic as well at a slightly later time. Can I have a book that writes about all four of these, please, and compares them to each other?
Yeah, I know very little about the Arabic tradition. Most linguists at least know the name Panini. That first N has a little dot under it in English, so it has a kind of palatalized vibe. But it also means his name is great. If you, I know more than one university that has the Panini cafe and sandwich shop, because that's a great multilingual pun to use.
Who can resist a pun? Yeah, and I learned a bit about the Arabic grammatical tradition when I was taking a bit of Arabic in undergrad. And there are a whole bunch of things that that grammatical tradition does, also in the tradition of we're going to look at our language and figure out, you know, kind of catalog it in exhaustive detail and figure out exactly what's going on in it. One of the things that I remember was that there's a sort of exhaustive catalyzation of what they call the binyan, which are the sort of templates that you can slot your three consonant roots into and how you put the vowels in between them that mean all of these sorts of different things.
Because Arabic is very interested in what happens in shifting the vowels of the language rather than what happens at the end of a word, like the Latin tradition.
Yeah, it's very relevant in Arabic, all of the different things you can do with the vowels in between them, and whether you maybe you double a consonant in a particular context, or you put this vowel here or that vowel there. So if you have a, you know, the classic triconsonantal root that everybody cites is KTB, Ktb, which has to do with books and writing. So Kitab is a book, and Kutub is books, and Maktab is office, and Kataba is he writes. So you can do all sorts of things with, you know, those three consonants and how you arrange the vowels between them. And there's sort of an abstract way of representing, here's what the patterns are with a you know, a sort of template verb that you can show all the patterns with, and going through and exhaustively cataloging the patterns. Like, this is the exciting thing to do if you're an ancient Arabic grammarian. I'm excited about it just thinking about it. But that's very much influenced by sort of the structure of the language. And I don't know as much about what Panini was doing, except for the fact that he gets cited in a lot of interlinguistics classes as the first grammarian.
Yeah, part of why he gets cited a lot is because he's excellent, and I'll talk about that. I think part of why as well is that Panini synthesized and brought together kind of everything that had been happening in the Sanskrit grammar tradition. And Sanskrit is kind of like the Indian linguistic area equivalent of Latin, which is that it was the language of sacred texts and religion, and it's a language that is still handed down. People still learn Sanskrit in the way they learn Latin. But in that area, languages like Hindi and Nepali, the Indo-Aryan languages, are all kind of later siblings and children of Sanskrit. So it's a very convenient analogy to Latin to draw with Sanskrit. And I think also the kind of motivation for thinking a lot about the language came from a theological attempt within Hinduism to understand kind of truth through language and understand how language works. It was one of the core areas of study within the kind of larger religious tradition. And so that was the kind of motivation. But Panini, we know his name. We know not too much else about him, except that he wrote at least 2,500 years ago. But he synthesized this work and he name drops like 10 other people whose work he draws on, and we've lost the record of all of their work.
No.
So I think he is excellent. That's not in dispute, but it's also just a kind of convenient prominence that he receives through being the kind of earliest record we have when the work was going on for thousands of years beforehand.
The person whose manuscript survives with his name attached to it.
Yeah, absolutely. A very convenient way to appear to be very excellent is just to have none of the foundational work you draw on exist still.
No. This is like the Library of Alexandria all over again.
But what made Panini's approach really distinct, and distinct from what was happening with those kind of learner-driven motivations for analyzing Latin, is that there was a logical progress to how he set out his description of Sanskrit. And similar to what we talked about with modern grammars, where you kind of start with the base elements of the sound system and then build up to words and parts of words. And if something goes on a word after another bit, so you'll describe the earlier bits first and build outwards. So it's this kind of logical order and progress
So in a very real sense, the order that Panini devised, you know, over 2,500 years ago is reflected in the order of the grammar that you wrote a few years ago.
And it's absolutely not an accident. The early 20th century linguists like Saussure, Franz Bopp were directly reading Panini and going, this guy was doing this stuff like thousands of years before we started thinking about it, and were directly influenced by Panini's approach to thinking about how the language worked and thinking about it very descriptively. This is why he's known as the first grammarian within even the Western tradition, because he was like, look, there's these words and they have these histories, but actually the important thing is that we think about how the words are being used by people now. The funny thing is he wrote that about what we now think of as classical Sanskrit, and people right. have not moved on from thinking about classical Sanskrit in that way, and it's become a learning tool. But
we should all just be speaking classical Sanskrit.
The motivation is exactly the same motivation we use in a descriptive grammar now. It's not about setting out the rules of a language and how it has to work. It reflects how a linguist has analyzed that people are using that system.
And I think that's one of the things that comes up when we talk about a grammar, is particularly because grammar in the Western tradition is associated with Latin, and okay, you're learning about the grammar of English only so that you can translate Latin into English better, mm-hmm. rather than learning about the grammar of English as an object of its own study. And this sort of translates into, okay, well, what if we made the grammar of English more like Latin, because that would obviously be better. And that's where this sort of secondary meaning of grammar as, you know, like, thou shalt not split an infinitive sort of does, because, you know, in Latin, an infinitive is just all one word. You can't split it. It's just one word.
You can't split it.
And, you know, this idea that grammar is a tool to beat people over the head with comes from this sort of like, well, you know, you've got to learn this language in school because this is how you're going to access all of these sort of classical texts that you are supposed to access. And you need to do it a certain way because it's dead now and it's not evolving. And so you're just learning to do this very particular thing. That's where this additional connotation of grammar as a stick to beat people over the head with comes in.
And that's that kind of very Latin tradition that we still have.
And it's not only English that had grammar as a sort of a tool to, you know, stay in touch with a lost golden age. Like, they, you know, this is also what they were doing in ancient Chinese, of like, you know, here's this older thing. One of the other interesting things that I learned about, you know, the Chinese grammatical tradition, in particular with the writing system, because the writing system in Chinese can obscure different pronunciations. Mm-hmm. So you could have a poem that you could still read in the written sense that's very old, but for a modern reader, it doesn't necessarily rhyme.
Yeah.
And at a certain point when they were doing more historical linguistics, they realized, oh, this poem actually rhymed back in the day. And the pronunciation has changed so much that we weren't really thinking about it because the characters look the same, but it actually used to rhyme, which, you know, sometimes shows up when you're reading Shakespeare or something and it's got like throne and drown or something. Yeah. And like, wait, those probably are supposed to rhyme based on where they are in this poem, but you can kind of use that to reconstruct what was going on.
And there's something very, it can feel a bit anxiety provoking about committing an analysis to paper, because you are kind of pinning a butterfly for a moment in time, but people are still speaking the language and it moves on. And as long as you don't think of the descriptive grammar as anything kind of more canonical and authoritative than people's actual intuitions, that's an important thing to remember, especially if you're working with a grammar that's more than a few generations old. It may be that the person didn't quite capture what people were doing. It may be that the language has changed again.
Yeah. And another thing that I found really interesting about, you know, sort of what are the ideas that people were thinking about at the time? So this is from Grammar West to East again. And the author points out that when Chinese characters first became known in Europe, it was the late 16th century. And in Europe, for unrelated reasons, mm-hmm. the idea of a universal language was like the hot philosophical topic.
Yes.
You know, you had people like John Wilkins, who ultimately created Rage's Thesaurus, but he was really just trying to make like a universal taxonomy for understanding the world. He ended up making, you know, quite a nice thesaurus, but not making a universal way of understanding the world. So what was actually going on in China at the time was that classical Chinese was a scholarly and diplomatic lingua franca of the East Asian region, mm-hmm. and it was acquired as a learned language in the different parts of those regions, and the Chinese words given a local pronunciation. So children in different parts of China would learn to read using a literary register of their local dialect, and there wasn't an idea of a standard spoken language for the whole country. That's a modern innovation. And this is a situation that was a lot like Latin in Europe at the time.
Yes.
But Europe, you know, you learn Latin in school so you can do the literary thing. But European scholars misunderstood the situation and thought that this meant that Chinese characters were interpretable by speakers of any language without them being based on one language, even though they were very much based on, you know, an ancestral language of the region.
Oh, dear. And their obsession with universality meant that they came to this very functional but, like, still based on a language thing. Oh, dear. I see exactly where this is going. It's no good.
Yeah. And also, they did the same thing with the Egyptian hieroglyphs, which had not yet been deciphered yet.
Right.
And they were like, guys, we found it. We found the universal language of ideas. And it's not tied to a particular language.
Not translated adds an extra air of mystery.
Oh, yeah. And it's really, you know, European scholars thought this was great. Like, Francis Bacon thought this was amazing. So it's interesting to see not just like, okay, here's this thing that was going on in China at the time, which is kind of interesting, but also here's how these things get sort of reflected and refracted, whether that's the Europeans approaching Chinese grammar as like maybe this thing that's universal, or this Chinese, you know, grammarian, Mr. Ma, looking at it and saying, okay, how could I sort of merge these two grammatical traditions of the full words versus the empty words, and then also what if I had, you know, nouns and adjectives and stuff, and how could I sort of group them in ways that make sense for the grammar of the language. Everyone's bringing their own preconceived notions to this space.
I think the descriptive grammar has really kind of figured itself out as a genre in the 20th century, and a lot of the discussion around how to make sure people aren't just bringing themselves to it has been to widen the scope of what gets included.
Mm-hmm.
And so one really kind of big influence has been the idea that you need to have the grammar, but it has to be presented alongside the word lists, because the grammar just tells you the rules, not which words go in which places.
Mm.
And also a collection of texts that are kind of broken down and translated so that people can access what's happening in narratives. And that solves a little bit of that what gets included problem.
Because somebody could always go back and look at the text again and say, well, what if I, you know, interpreted them differently or wrote this grammar differently based on what I can see here in this longer thing.
Yeah, the author didn't get around to a section on the use of kind of particles in narratives, but there's enough texts here, I can see what's happening. This little trio of publications is sometimes known as the Boasian Trinity, which sounds a little bit more pompous and religious than it actually is, but it's part of this expanding what gets included.
And this is after Boas, whose first name I've forgotten.
Franz Boas.
Franz Boas. Yes. And he was, you know, he was one of the early grammarians in this sort of descriptive and comparative tradition where it's not just, okay, every intellectual in this one country or this one society is devoting themselves to this one language, but, oh, what if we looked at lots of languages? What if we compared them? And this goes along with the colonial project of, like, you know, what if we went and conquered some people?
Yes. There's a lot of scientific rationalism happening here.
Yeah. You know, this is not entirely unproblematic either. But it is interesting how the forms of the grammar start shifting when it stops being sort of, you know, seeking this one language of like, oh, everything descends from Greek or everything descends from Sanskrit. Even the Europeans at a certain point when they encountered Sanskrit were like, oh, everything must descend from Sanskrit, and said, okay, well, what if we realize that we can't actually know what the first language was? This is lost in the mists of time, and figured out what can we know about relationships and what is sort of the possibility space for what are different things that languages do?
I mean, I think it's also worth pointing out a lot of 20th century language description has happened to try and translate religious texts and kind of political documents, and that is a subset of problematic colonization within the grammatical tradition.
Yeah, and the longest text that's been written down in a lot of languages is the Bible, which has all sorts of really weird consequences when you start using those parallel texts as the input for something like machine translation, because you can have machine translation systems start spitting out things that sound like religious prophecies because they're just sort of regurgitating versions of that Bible input, which is pretty weird.
Such a weird consequence of a weird set of earlier decisions.
Exactly. And, you know, like, here was this earlier decision that maybe this was even a religious text that was created 100 years ago by some missionary. And, you know, but it's the longest text that's available in this language, and the grammar is maybe more or less accurate. And yet, and it wasn't trying to record the stories and the oral histories of the people who actually spoke that language that they cared about themselves. It was trying to introduce this foreign religion to them.
Again, it's one of those things that is hard to avoid, and so it's just important to be aware of when you're looking at some grammars, and they may have a lot of Christian religious texts. It doesn't necessarily reflect the religion of the speakers so much as the religion of the person doing the documentation.
Yeah, and going back to that theme of grammars, they're made by people, and sometimes people's agendas for making a grammar is
a different endpoint.
Yeah, it's less about like, oh, I want to help this language be taught in schools, or be like support its speakers in their own goals, and more, I want to sort of impose my goals on the speakers.
I think another important change that has happened across the 20th century in terms of grammars is the increasing availability of recording equipment, and therefore the ability to make recordings of the language as a kind of fourth part of that three-part collection of what's important when documenting a language.
There are some really interesting ancient recording technologies, like the wax cylinders that were used sort of.
Yeah, you say ancient, but you mean like 150 years ago.
Yeah, not ancient compared to Panini.
Not Panini ancient, just it's really the story of the 20th century descriptive tradition is the story of embracing these recording methods.
There was a really cool thing where they had these old cracked wax cylinders, I think it was in the Smithsonian, and they couldn't put them on a machine to read them because obviously the needle would stumble over the cracks. It's kind of like a record.
They just fall apart.
But picture it as a tall record with all the lines tall rather than a flat record. But it was cracked, so they couldn't put it in a thing, and they eventually figured it away with lasers to read the recordings. And I got to hear, you know, here's a song in this language that hasn't been heard for 100 years because the cylinder cracked and they encountered it. If it's online, I'll try to find a link to it.
And so with recording technology early on, and even for some linguists, it's mostly about doing recordings so you can go back and listen yourself and really identify that you're correctly analyzing structures. But I think the more exciting thing is that it lets you really observe more people using language in more natural ways, the kind of, can you say this? Can you say that? Does that sound grammatical? Way of eliciting stuff can lead to a kind of unusual way of approaching the language, but really drawing on people singing songs and telling stories not only makes for a richer, more realistic grammatical description that allows you to kind of see those kind of fuzzier, more complicated bits of language, but also means that you can make those recordings available for speakers who are interested in going back to a kind of oral history of the language, for people who might come in the future and go, oh, you didn't look at the way people's prosody goes up and down and their intonation changes in stories. I'm going to look at that and I have access to these recordings. And I think this is where grammars are more exciting as we integrate more of that richness of actual language and bringing the people who speak the language back into real prominence within the grammar document.
Yeah, because there is a certain way of writing a grammar which is very old, which sort of just assumes that whatever bits you have about here's how this language works, you know, that sort of information just exists at this abstract level and it's not necessarily tied to particular speakers or particular communities. And saying, oh, it would be good to give credit to the speakers who were saying this, or to, you know, identify this is a particular way that a language is spoken in a particular region, or here's something that's going on here. And there have been some initiatives to do things like pair people who are trying to revitalize their languages with linguists to try to understand what's going on in some of these older grammars, because they can be hard to decipher without the special training. The one that I'm familiar with is Breath of Life.
And there are the paper and talk workshops in Australia as well, where you're kind of coming full circle and making sure that you give people the tools that they need to access the materials about their own language, because, you know, you can make grammars for many reasons, and we've discussed some of them, but at the end of the day, the most important reason to me is that speakers of a language can access the materials that were created for that language.
And I think when we look at the multi-thousand-year-old history of making grammars And the very different sorts of questions that people had about language thousands of years ago, I find it very humbling, because we can think about what are the questions that people might be asking in another 1,000 years, and how can we make things that would help with that?
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, schwa pins, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I tweet and blog as Superlinguo.
I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com. And my book about internet language is called Because Internet. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 49 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm, or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include reduplication, a Q&A with a lexicographer, and a Q&A with the two of us in honor of our 100th episode. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their life.
Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Doppiarella, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic!